All right, ladies and gentlemen, welcome to round one of Pro Play Tour Las Vegas. I'm Alex Simo, joined by Mr. Joseph Rothschild. And I told you we'd be back really quick because the players in the main field have already started. Our feature match is getting set up. We're going to have Ediception in the very first feature match. This is what I was saying. Like, the amount of killers in this field is just going to be insane to witness this entire weekend.
It's round one. Like, this is what we get to start out round one with. And he is on a particularly interesting deck. Like we were just saying, an Orcist build that has a couple of very interesting techs that you are pretty knowledgeable about.
Yeah, it's Lunalite Orcist. Lunalite Orcist, again, this is a deck that it's not as powerful, I would say. Actually, that's not true. The ceiling of Lunalite Orcist is ridiculous, but I think it's kind of a more of a glass cannon style of approach. It's funny because Ed told me he wasn't actually supposed to even be here today, so he actually assembled this kind of last minute, but Lunalite Orcist is a deck he said he feels pretty comfortable with, and the deck's crazy.
Yeah, for sure.
And going up against a tried and true Brandon Hornke is actually going to be playing Sky Striker. I mean, this is a great round one match. It's pretty representative of the meta. You know, it's going to be a pretty good back and forth, I would say, unless Ed just opens the absolute nuts.
Which could happen.
Yeah, I mean, also Brandon could too. I mean, Sky Striker is also capable of very powerful openings.
Certainly. While Orcist is prides itself on its ability to play through hate and multiple pieces of disruption, Lunalite Orcist prides itself on its ability to combo off. So a heads-up control deck like Sky Striker could draw the outs that are necessary to prevent it from popping off, or they could fall to its unbelievable amount of extenders.
And without further ado, let's go ahead and get into that round one feature match for you guys. And here we go. Hopefully. I think the players already rolled dice. I'm not sure who won.
Obviously, a lot rides on who goes first. Sky Striker, of course, needs to be finding something like a Widow Anchor in order to prevent Lunalite Orcist from popping all the way off. And there's the handshake.
And we're off. Round one of 12. Are you ready, Joseph?
I'm ready now. Call me back in a couple of minutes and we'll see.
So, wow, it looks like Ed won the die roll.
Ooh, that's really bad for Sky Striker.
Yeah.
One of the many ways that straight-up Sky Striker builds can sort of accommodate for the multiple combo lines that something like Lunalite Orcist is capable of doing is by playing extremely powerful floodgates like there can be only one. Of course, those get less good when your opponent is able to make their entire play beforehand.
So there's a Dark Greffer pitching a Nessie, and that's going to special summon the Greffer to the field. Nessie will trigger since it was discarded, adding a copy of Jackalope to Ed's hand. You gotta feel pretty good if Greffer is your first card, and there is Tenki as well. That's one of the reasons why Lunalite Orcist is so strong, because the number of starters this deck has is actually, it's really higher than average. And I think that's just what kind of just gives it this level of consistency. We see Kaleidochik coming down now. It's going to send probably Yellow Martin to the graveyard as cost here, and it looks like it will.
Brandon looking at his hand, I don't think you want to negate the actual effect of of Kaleidochik.
Absolutely not. A lot of players, you know, still, if they're not familiar with Lunalites, think that they can ash that effect, but you cannot. It sends as cost, and he opened the Tiger as well, so he has the full combo. Lunalite Tiger going into the scale that allows you to resurrect one of your Lunalite monsters.
And here's the power of this. I mean, this is the fourth summon, I believe.
This is the fourth summon.
What do you think the next one's going to be?
Yep. And
I'm thinking real quick. If there's one card you probably want to stop, it might be Azathoth, provided you've got extra hand traps in hand.
So now he used the effect of Nyarla here to swap the materials of his monsters underneath the Nyarla with one in his graveyard. This actually triggers the effect of the Yellow Martin, and that allowed him to search the Lunalite Serenade Dance, which is a trap card, but it's mainly just used as an extender because you can just discard it later on. Azathoth hits the board. That's going to stop Brandon from using any other effects this turn. Not like it actually matters.
And I think that was a discard of the Jackalope off of this Dark Greffer. Man, Dark Greffer is extremely powerful, but it's even better when you're able to special summon it with something like a Nessie. There are so few cards that enable that in this deck. They're basically just the large dangers and World Wand.
Now here comes a Bigfoot summon off of the Jackalope. Interesting, I'm not sure if that matters or if that's just something he wanted to get out of his deck by chance.
Notably, it's got a very interesting typing that enables a Curious play.
Yeah, absolutely. So Curious is going to hit the board now, and again, Edge is going to continue to combo off here. He's going to go completely unimpeded because all monster effects are shut down thanks to the Azathoth. He's going to send Lunalite Perfume off the Curious here.
So that's pretty good blind. I would have liked to have seen something like an Imperial Order sent, but that's a little too spicy. While that was kind of the flavor of the month in early Lunalite Orcist decks, the better version is probably just playing heads-up cards that enable extenders into Orcist plays. There's no need to play unfair when your fair game is so strong.
So Ed also milled three for Curious's effect as well, because since he decided to mill the Perfume.
Did he hit a Serenade Dance?
No, he hit an Impermanence. He hit an Impermanence, so he added Serenade Dance off of the Yellow Martin, and now he's going to...
Of course, we can discard it this way.
Correct, yeah. So you just banish Perfume, discard a card, and you get to add a Lunalight card from your deck to your hand. That card is... It's just like extender after extender after extender.
It's extremely powerful, but what feels unfair about this deck is specifically that Lunalight Tiger is not a hard once per turn.
You saw
Ed added another one to his hand. I think we'll see its effect activated a couple more times over the course of the turn.
So now we see the Serenade Dance is going to special summon a copy of Emerald Bird. Emerald Bird's effect, not super relevant. It's mainly just primarily used as an extender piece that you can just play that's another name. We're going to see the Yellow Martin bounce the Tiger back to the hand here, and that's going to allow him to reuse the Tiger. He also has 2/4s, notably, that he can go ahead and make a Zephyros to grab a copy of... Four Strix to get the Zephyros, excuse me.
Lunalight Emerald Bird is a card that you routinely see shaved in these decks, but I don't like seeing that. I think Emerald Bird is an incredibly powerful one-of that you can flex into in scenarios like this.
So now we're going to possibly see a rank 4 play. I imagine that's where he wants to go with this. Yes, so here
comes
4-Strix. Typically, 4-Strix is seen at the earlier stages of the combo as well, but obviously using it later, it works just the same.
Depends very much on how many extenders you have in your hand. If you're able to do the entirety of the combo, you, of course, are going to be able to make 4-Strix at any point. But if you intend to do sort of minimal versions of the combo with exclusively Nibiru Insurance and Orcist plays, there's no need to go into it anything but early.
So here comes another Tiger in the scale here that's going to allow Ed to special summon yet another Lunalight from the graveyard to go for this Yellow Martin again.
Wow, just a big misplay from Ed. You're not going to be able to perform a Pendulum Summon.
Now, Yellow Martin is also going to... Yellow Martin is only a hard once per turn, so he's not going to get to continuously bounce that Tiger, but it doesn't matter. Here comes a Tornado Dragon. Now he gets to pop.
Clear out that scale.
Yep, clear out the scale, and then this he just gets to keep going. It's crazy.
This is so debilitating to play against. So if you're Brandon, what are you thinking about? Number one, you got to find a way to clear the field. And likely that only happens by way of something like a Floodgate that allows you to get a 2-for-1. Secondly, you have to figure out a way to out Avramax. That's not too easy for Sky Striker to do.
I was going to say, what is the way Striker outs Avramax?
It's one of those things that you have to engineer a scenario in which you're doing unfair things. The Tornado Dragon really complicates things because even if he finds a Mystic Mine, you can chain to the activation, right? So there's not a ton that's available to you in terms of beating up this board, and Ed's going to have absolutely everything he needs over the course of this turn.
Right, because it's not even just the Avramax, right? It's also the fact that he's going to have full Orcist combo. He's even sending the Gizmek already to set up in addition to that. Like, if Brandon can break this board, I will be thoroughly impressed. I think the Avramax is probably like the biggest of his worries.
So if you see the Tornado Dragon, I think that you're assuming your opponent has some inkling of what you're playing. But if you get the read that they don't, do you ever consider just scooping game one?
The thing is, Tornado Dragon's actually like a pivotal part of the Lunalight combo. So it's like some people obviously want to, like, you would think, oh, if you're making Tornado Dragon, it's kind of like Blinding Dweller against a graveyard deck, right? But Tornado Dragon actually is an extender for the Lunalight Orcist strategy because you pop your own Tiger, which triggers its effect. So it's not like this is a Sky Striker-specific call here.
You're making me so angry. Why is this allowed to happen?
Interesting that Ed actually left the Galatea up. Does that mean he opened the Crescendo?
There is a set card.
Wow, okay. So
we may have missed the set of the Crescendo off of a Galatea effect.
Oh, fair, yeah.
I actually would consider just moving to game two if I were Brandon. Just like... saying, okay, I'm not going to let you know what I opened. I'm playing something that loses to Lunalight Orcist, which could be anything. And this actually doesn't give away too much information. You know, both Sky Striker and Sky Striker Orcist are on Hornet Drones, and if you're finding it in your opener, it kind of does telegraph that you're on the ladder. Going into Hayate, however, doesn't. So now Ed should completely know what's up, and it's time to play Yukio.
So Hayate's here. Shark Cannon. Okay, so he's going to just immediately go for a banish.
I think he's telegraphing. He's aiming to activate a engage for an additional draw over the course of this turn. If we Shark Cannon here and then send a card off of Hayate and we have an engage in opener, you know, we should be able to clean that up. But any of these scenarios are just from such a back foot position. It's going to take a lot to win this one.
Okay, second Shark Cannon.
Yikes.
Okay, so
I've been there.
Yeah, this is rough because, again, even if Brandon does deal with all this, how do you deal with the Avramax? Like, that is the most imposing card that Brandon has to face down at this point. And it's the outs are so limited for Striker that I'll be really interested to see that. Even if he outs the entire board, I think Avramax is going to just pose the biggest problem here.
So we actually saw round one of the last Pro Play Tour event, a player playing main deck Gamseel. And then boarded copies of things like Lava Golem to out cards like Avramax that are problematic. You know, if Brandon is on something spicy like that, that's potentially a very easy way to clean it up. And if he is, you know, using Hayate to send Engage and then going into Kagari is actually a very winning line.
So I think it's time to think here. I don't think he's attacked yet.
No, we haven't been to the battle phase.
Because, we haven't. We would have seen a Hayate send if he did.
Jet's got a pretty good point. You probably don't want to be banishing Kaleido Chicks at this stage of the game. All right, there's the crescendo.
Now, that gets banished, right, which is very important because now at this point...
You saw him pick up the extra deck to go into Kagari before realizing, oh, no.
Yeah. It's not Salamence Great Roar. It actually banishes, and that's a pretty big difference in this particular instance here. Now, to be fair, you can just Hayate send another one.
Yeah, but then you're out of a battle phase, and you lose a lot of the way in which you're cleaning up some of these errant adds, things like the Tornado Dragon with one material, which otherwise threatens your extremely threatenable multi-roll.
So he's going to go Kaina.
All right. We're going to read Avramax real quickly. Ed says, okay, sure.
So he's going to go after Tornado Dragon, it looked like, with the Kaina?
Mm-hmm.
And going to Shizuku.
Oh, yikes.
Ooh.
That's
is he just
going
to end? Man, no attack or anything. He has an Imperm in his hand.
He drew it as his sixth card.
Ooh. That never. That feels bad.
Thinking about setting it, I think I probably would have put it in one of the Pendulum Zones.
Yeah. Might All be a right. slight misstep from Brandon there, because he could have put it in the far right column where he knows the Tiger already is. That way he could have negated Tiger from activating.
So this game, Brandon prioritizing adding this copy of Engage to his hand at the end step with Shizuku rather than using Kagari to recycle an Engage that he sends off of something like a Hayate. I don't know if I love it, but a lot's going to rest on the card that's on the far left that we don't know about. If it's something that can potentially clean up the board, Brandon might be in a pretty good position. But if it's anything that's only slightly relevant, this might be the end of the game.
Yeah, I mean, this is pretty easy cleanup, right? Like, he didn't even go Tornado Dragon in end phase. I mean, he could have just easily, and Digirsu's just going to clean up one back row here.
He's going to send it. Brandon's thinking about chaining. Nope, doesn't work like that, friend.
Ooh, it's just a Hercules base.
Obviously, yeah. It doesn't matter if it's face down, but isn't even destroyed.
Yeah, I love Dingirsu, right? The fact that it sends.
Do I? Do I have to love Dingirsu?
You just out so many things.
We are going to go for the Hercules base. Potentially, I'm wrong. The first time that's ever happened.
It's just so rough. I mean, Brett, it's facing down this board. For any deck, facing down a board that Ed assembled is so difficult.
Yeah. One of the things that Striker really lost when the Widow Anchor hit rolled out was the ability to survive. Now it's got a pretty critical weakness in that it isn't able to just randomly get blockers from its opponent's graveyard inside of the field, and occasionally a combo deck like this one might just be able to clean it up, discarding the Zephyros. Come on.
Man. Because why not, right? You know, we just need more extenders.
I think you're probably targeting Tornado Dragon here, just forcing the issue before the activation of the Tiger actually happens.
I mean, at this point, it's rough for Brandon. I don't know if it really matters at this point what he's targeting, because I think Ed just can easily clean up here.
Yeah.
Like, there's not even a Ray in the graveyard from the Striker player at this point, so it's... There's no even, like, recursion there.
We know the one card in hand. It's Engage.
It's Engage.
It's a good card, but it is not Battle Fader. It's not Gores, and we might see a pretty devastating attack step.
Yeah, no, this should be lethal. I'm almost fairly certain.
To chat asking, it is a one-day event.
Yes, we are doing – this is round one of 12, I think. So we're going to be doing 8 rounds of Swiss, and then we'll be cutting immediately to top 16 and diving straight into that.
Oh, yikes. Oh, a Link 4.
Here comes Boral Sword.
Be still my heart.
Oh, Unicorn. Okay.
We're going to Unicorn to tuck back the Shizuku, and that works too, right? That's 19-22 3K.
Yeah, so that's pretty much. This has to be game. He gets to draw from the unicorn here because it's co-linked. He can bounce to get Zephyros back. That already right there should represent game.
Yeah. And real quick, just detailing the combo, and that's it, folks.
Yep, that's going to do it. So game one goes to Ed. Again, that's Lunalight Orcus going first.
The grand tournament of the series is upon us as Season 2 comes to a close with the Pro Play Tour Invitational, where players will be playing for $25,000 in cash and prizes. Still not qualified? Last chance qualifiers will occur on day 1 of our 3-day event and will fire every 8 players, awarding a box in prizing and invites. Be ready to play a few, because LCQs are only $10. Saturday is day 1 of the main event with a top competitor playoff following on Sunday. Stick around for day 3, where we will have team events as well as a variety of side events. For more information, visit ppgeventmanagement.com and come play with the pros.
So it looks like we're going into game 2. Brandon has elected to start, I expect.
I would definitely hope so.
I see some trap cards in the hand, so
I feel pretty good.
I can't imagine that he did not.
I think that's
evenly?
Was that? Was that evenly?
I don't know about keeping an evenly going.
Are you sure that
first.
Was evenly?
I'm not.
That kind of looked like compulse to me.
Compulse would be reasonable here too.
That's also something we've seen in Striker Build of the past, so that's not like too surprising.
This is weird. Obviously, you don't want to go into Kagari because you don't have anything in the graveyard. You don't want to go into Hayate really because it doesn't do anything. Oh, is he telegraphing a hand that doesn't have any way to extend?
Ooh,
yikes.
Now, to be fair, if those back row are actually like floodgates, but I mean, that the look on Brandon's face, he was shaking his head. He's like, yeah, this is what I got to do.
It doesn't really count as a nonverbal if it's completely telegraphed by your opening play.
Yeah.
Shizuku Pass has won a lot of players, a lot of games. Ed chuckling as well. Well, I guess we'll see if those trap cards are any good.
Yeah, like if Brandon's back row's real, like this is fine.
Yeah.
We'll just have to see, though.
So. And Ed says, all right.
Danger effect. Here we go. Gonna hit the fifth card.
Ooh, that is a good one to send to the graveyard.
That's a pretty good hit.
I'm pretty happy about it.
Okay, so here comes Tsuchinoko. Ed's gonna get a fresh draw here.
Brandon's like, ooh, what am I flipping up against? The danger.
We're gonna set a card now.
In the pendulum zone, no less. Oh, nope, moves it over real quick.
He's like, no, I want that zone open. Interesting though, because he didn't. He actually put it in a zone that one of the back row was in for Brandon. So
and of course,
Tiger.
That's probably why Brandon has played everything in non-pendulum zones. If you have something like a single impermanence, you can't really count on your opponent not just playing into the open pendulum zone. But if you don't, you can potentially negate their spells and traps because they'll want to keep those open regardless.
So here comes another danger effect. He's going to hit the middle card here. Hits the harp. So Nessie comes down. Ed gets to draw. Orcus combo's online now. Brandon just wants to take a quick read of Harpoor here. Yes, it is one of the best cards of the format.
I hear it's all right. If you have a Shark Cannon, now is the time.
And for those of you who just saw the recent OCG ban list, Harpoor just got hit.
Oh,
ooh,
speaking
Shark
of.
Cannon. Okay. That's pretty good.
It's all right.
Yeah.
It kind of does end the turn if Ed doesn't have a lot of other play starters.
Now,
normal summoned.
This is one of the reasons why we see a lot of players opting to main deck DD Crow is because if Babel's not online, you can just immediately hit the Harp out of the graveyard, and it's like a pseudo Ash Blossom without having to use an actual Ash Blossom because Ash Blossoms are hard ones per turn.
Right, of course.
And also just having synergy with the deck as well. Here comes Phoenix now from Ed.
Oh, yikes. This is not a great opener. If he discards a Lunalight here, it's much better.
That's a Zephyros. That's not the worst.
The Zephyros. Well, at least we found a way to get it into the graveyard. We can bring back the Tiger from the graveyard, or does Tiger prevent itself?
Ooh,
what a snipe.
There can be only one. I hear that card's pretty good.
Yeah, and that's what we expected. I mean, Sky Striker has the ability to play with and around this card, and as a result, it will board into it as often as possible.
I will say one of the things about There Can Be Only One is the fact that when it comes to Lunalight Orcas in particular, they do play a wide variety of different types. All the dangers are different types.
Right.
The Lunalights are all roughly Beast Warriors, but your Xyz and your Lynx are just a wide myriad of different types.
You know, you've got Wing Beasts in here. It gets you into scenarios where it's not particularly hard to make something like a... Ooh.
Whoa.
Oh. Chat, we may be losing power.
That's not good. Assuming we're still live.
It looks like we are. The computer is still on. I believe what has happened is someone has leaned on a light panel.
Is that what happened?
Oh, wow. Well, stick with us, chat.
Well, this is YCS, or YCS, this is Pro Play Tour Las Vegas, so, you know, maybe we're going to have the club lights and the...
Yeah. And the lights are
flipping
back on.
There we go. Oh, we got our lights back on, at least.
They're coming up in pieces. If you go to an event, folks, please remember, do not lean back on any light panels. They're slowly coming back online. What looks like happened is the strip got too excited. They had to reroute power. That's how this town works, right?
To be fair, I've been to regionals and tournaments at this venue for... Las Vegas events are always at this venue. I've never seen this happen in all the times that I've been here.
An omen? Is this place haunted? You decide, chat.
So the lights are...
Chat says allure of darkness.
Or is it the beginning of the end?
Oh my gosh. Oh, boy. Orchestrated blackout? Okay, I'll take that one.
The lights are slowly coming back on. We're about like halfway lit now.
Imagine your play being so tight that God himself tries to stop you.
I think the players are still going, though.
Yeah,
it looks like it.
And we're back.
Okay.
So let's normal summon a Yellow Martin and pretend like nothing happened.
Good thing we have that extra light set up next to them. It's almost like
sure.
We didn't even like predict something like this was going to happen, but it's kind of a good thing that we did.
Yeah, and also very glad that the computer didn't punk out. Thank you for sharing this moment with us, chat.
Yeah. So we're going to see Ed go for a Nyarla here. Nyarla is going to go ahead and rotate those materials once again. This is going to allow Ed to get a search of Lunalight Serenade Dance.
Yeah, this is the important part. Going into something like an Azathoth isn't particularly good because, you know, your opponent doesn't have a ton, and the best they can have is a bunch of hand traps they should have activated already. But getting that Serenade Dance is particularly powerful.
Yeah, just being able to get the extender, I think at this point you're just trying to go for the kill. I mean, Brandon only has one back row at this point. You're basically ensuring that no other hand traps are going to come down, which, to be fair, Striker's hand trap count has decreased over the past few months, I would say.
Shouts out to when they were playing, like, 9-plus impermanence.
Right?
We're back on, like, Ash and nothing else.
For sure. So here comes Lunalight. Tiger going to resurrect the Yellow Martin. God. Non-hard once per turns. In 2019. What
a world. Ed's kind of finagled away into the combo here. This is about everything you want to do. We're going to tuck that very last card, getting a Serenade Dance into the graveyard in the process.
That's going to allow him to further extend his play here. I'm curious if he can go for the kill.
Brandon, what's the set?
Oh, nope. Nothing useful. But if anything, this is definitely just showing the power level of Lunalight Orcus for sure. Here comes the Yellow Martin now. And now that doesn't represent lethal damage here. Serenade Dance, if he has another card, he can pitch to special summon another monster. I do not know the composition of Ed's extra deck, but, you know, two level fours does represent game in some instances.
I don't think this deck is playing it.
This is Ed we're talking about, though.
Well,
Ed's known for playing wacky stuff.
Never say never, I suppose. Yeah, we're going to go into what appears to be a 3.
He used a 3 and 2 1s, so yeah. Curious, okay.
All right, we're just playing the combo here. We'll just go into Orcus things and win that way. Seems like a good idea. While going for the OTK might be a little more flashy, procking the effect of Shizuku and then tagging out the Ray is probably slightly better.
Yep, so here we go. We banished the the Wonder Wand that's going to, or World Wand, I keep saying Wonder Wand, World Wand, that's going to resurrect the Harp after he does his mandatory mill of Curious, of course.
Oh, did he hit a perfume?
I think. Wow.
That's pretty good. And Tiger's the last card in hand. That's a good one.
That seems pretty good.
This we already knew. It was returned already.
Mm-hmm. That was bounced off of the...
Bring back the Yellow Martin.
Yep.
And look real quick to see if there's another way in here to recycle it.
You have to remember, too, Azathoth is active, so the Ray will not be coming back.
Oh, you're right.
Yeah.
Clever. All right, here's Galatea.
Going to go ahead and banish.
Again. Oh, wow.
So now we get to get the symbol skeleton.
We'll link all of them away. Three, four, five, six.
To make Boral Sword. And then you use Spanish Skeleton to bring back the Galatea overlay for
one ding away, aren't we?
And that will be OTK right there.
Oh, man. That was textbook. Ed's kind of laughing real quick. Activate Ray. Whoa.
I think Ray can activate because of Azathoth.
Yeah.
Yep. It's showcasing
and
the Azathoth right there. Yep. That's going to be it.
That's the game.
Brandon's just going to go ahead and extend the handshake. I mean, that just...
Still looking to earn your invite to the $10,000 cash prize Pro Play Tour Invitational on January 24th through 26th in Orlando, Florida? Well, why not attend a Pro Play Tour qualifier at your local game store? Participating stores can host PPT qualifiers with their official Pro Play Tour store challenge kit. Interested in hosting a PPT qualifier of your own? Visit ppgeventmanagement.com to learn how your local game store can qualify to host Pro Play Tour qualifiers today.